great costumes in here. This is Wonder Woman costume, pretty great. Let's hear it for Wonder Woman. Yeah. We got some Lego bats over here. You guys like them? Day, a bunch of awesome costumes, a bunch of fun. Thank you guys so much for being here. Without further ado, let me introduce your moderator. Everybody, give a warm round of applause for Kevin Lyles!
Kevin!
I was happy to expect you all to go, Kev! So, how's everybody doing? Is everybody good? I was like, I gotta have it, so I asked for it, please. It's gonna be really cool. So, without any further ado, ladies and gentlemen, Norm Peterson himself, Mr. George Wendt. We had John Ratzenberger in SC just last year. So, how you doing today? Excellent, excellent. So I just thought I'd start right from the beginning. How did you get it? Well, not the beginning, but like the beginning of your career. Is that the So how did you perform? How did you get into acting?
I wanted to do something that I wouldn't hate, so I couldn't think of anything. The only thing I could think of that I wouldn't hate was to be in Second City in Chicago, which is this nightclub, which they just get in the market. And so I had no idea how hard it would be to get into that. So I just decided to take classes there, and sure enough, it worked out. I spent 6 years there. Although you never really leave, it's like the Marine Corps. You know, you still get calls to do the outgate. And after that, after 6 years there, met my wife there. We decided to go to LA to look for film TV work. And that was 1980, and then Cheers popped up in 1982.
Awesome. So you went there to look for film work, and bam, found Cheers. That's pretty good.
Film TV work, yeah.
That's excellent. So what was the audition process like for Cheers?
The better story is Ratzenberg's story, which I'll tell.
He told it just last year, right?
Yeah, yeah. Well, my story was, that I was not available for Cheers because I was on this other show. And, but they said, well, look, can you come in and do a guest spot? And my agent says, I've got to tell you, honey, it's just one line. Actually, it's one word. Actually, it's one syllable. And it was beer, of course. And it was supposed to be at the end of the episode, a little tag, where Shelley goes, hello, my name is Diane, I'll be your waitress. I'm not really a waitress, I'm an academic, blah, blah, blah. And she goes into her, page long spiel, like she always did. And then she said, I should probably take your order. And I go, and she said, what do they have? And I go, beer. But they cut that. They said, that's too small. Why don't you read this other role? And it was named George. And so the guy knew, just never was going to leave. And so then they said, all right, we want you to do it. And they, I wasn't allowed to do both shows, so they had me as a guest on the pilot and then had me as a regular once my other show was canceled. And just about 3 or 4 years ago, I found out that they were actually interested in me from the get-go, which was weird. I'm glad I didn't know. But it was named George, and I thought, that must be familiar. And the Charles Brothers and Jim Burroughs were being interviewed at UC Santa Barbara, and they asked me to show up as a surprise guest. So I'm sort of sitting there in the wings, just watching them because they're so funny and cool. And some audience member said, now, did you have anybody in mind when when you were writing Cheers for casting, and they go, oh my God, no. Oh, we saw everybody in Hollywood, you know, and this is Sam and Diane. And it said it took months and months. And then they go, but yeah, Rhea, yeah, we had her and I, and George. I'm like, what? Now you don't? But the better story is Ratzenberger goes in for George and senses that it wasn't going well. have you heard of this one? Okay, so that's good. He's sort of like, thank you very much, and he's thank you, and he literally, not figuratively, literally has one foot out the door. And pops his head back in and says, do you have a bar know-it-all? And they go, no, what do you mean? And he started improvising in that Cliff Clavin character. And they started laughing, and they wrote it into the show, and there you go. So, yeah, he had the mitzvah. But the dating Cliff Clavin was, I think, Jim Burrow's wife's gynecologist.
he didn't tell us that part. But since you left Ratzenberger, did you have any creation? Norm was, you know, 11 years it went on, so did you have any input in those years to the character? Any dialogue? Or
they didn't need much help from me. You know, they were such great, clever writers. I just accepted legally, you know, everything they sent my way.
I would say they would be much from you. I think you played that character. You played that character really well, didn't you? Now you're going to be
come on. Looking like a guy who needed a beer. You know, that's just like a lifetime in the making.
But, so, I mean, just to prove how popular Norm Peterson is, you played him for a record on 5 different series throughout your career. So that's not popular.
I think there's more.
My bad. I don't know. Norm Extra done.
I think, okay, so Cheers, does that count as one?
Absolutely.
Frank Cheers, Portality.
Portality's one.
Wings.
Frazier.
Frazier,
yeah.
St. Elsewhere.
Right, and now.
Simpsons.
Oh, that.
Family Guy.
Wow.
Simpsons was funny. I don't remember Family Guy too much, but Simpsons was, Norm got surly with Woody. Like, he wouldn't give me a beer. I'm like, give me a beer, Woody, and he's like, I don't know, Mr. Peterson, you've had. And I pick an empty beer bottle, I smash it over the bar, and I threaten him like I hold it to his throat. You dumb hick, give me a beer, kill Billy. They can get away with murder.
Did you have a favorite scene or episode for Norm, or just overall in Cheers? Did you have a favorite in part that maybe you weren't even in?
You know, one of my favorite episodes, and I don't know why, but when the boys all went skydiving, and to a man, we chickened out, so we're up in the plane and we've all completely bailed out on doing that, and but we can't tell them at the bar that we chickened out, and so we've got to come up with a story, right? Right, but we've got to be able to stick to the story, you know, so let's keep it very simple, keep it believable. Right. It's got to be simple and believable. So Sam goes, I got it. We jumped, the parachute's open, and we landed. It's simple, it's believable. Right, okay, there we go. Right, okay. Right, jump, parachute's open, and we landed. Right. So we get back to the bar, we're like, woo, oh my God, we're high-fiving, and that was amazing, I feel so alive. And Carla goes, whoa, what happened? Oh, it was fantastic. What? then she corners Woody. And Woody, what happened? And he goes, what? We jumped, the parachutes opened, and we landed. It was all very simple and believable. And then another favorite joke was another Woody joke. We were in some having a feud with Carrie's old tavern, and Woody got kidnapped or something, and we're like worried, concerned about his whereabouts. And then we see, you know, the stairs going down. There's a window, and we see Woody bound, gagged with like duct tape, and hanging by a noose from his feet, and then lowered him down into the window, and he's like two knees. And we run out to cut him down and save him, and he's like, he's trying to tell us something. What? You know, take the tape off of it. You're talking about oxygen!
So I was wondering if we could just we could go back to Cheers. And of course, we're going to open this to Q&A in a couple of minutes. But I just wanted to do a couple more parts of the program talk. One of my favorite TV shows is Columbo. And you played one of the killers in one of the last episodes of Columbo. And I was wondering if you could talk about that for a little bit.
Yeah, well, it was a thrill, you know, to be the bad guy. Columbo, I was really bad. I murdered my brother. So, you know, with the format, which I remember seeing, you know, in my younger days, but I sort of really didn't understand. But it's, you know, there's all these cat and mouse scenes with the killer. And the audience knows, and the fun was trying to find, how Columbo figured it out. And so, geez, we must have had maybe four, you know, like five-page cat and mouse scenes. And Peter was just amazing. That guy, he was just so much fun. Such great stories. And such a bulldog, you know, really just, we go over the motor and he said, no, don't do it that way. Don't, you know, and then I'd be looking at him when he was trying to tell me, you know, what to do. And I'd go, do it like that! And, okay. I've never seen anybody get laughs just by what the audience thinks he might say. Like, you know, somebody would ask a question and Peter would go, eat that one. And Peter, they would just break out laughing, just wondering what he was thinking.
And then those guys are talking about Peter Falk, because he's a star. You got to look around. I'm looking around at all these girls about my age, so don't feel questioned. But, another great character you had was Bob Swirsky, with, for those of you who don't know, that's the Peters. So I thought that
Joe Mantegna, okay, you know how it really came about was these guys were in Second City classes, much like the ones I took, and they were doing this a show at a bar called the Deja Vu on Lincoln Avenue in Chicago, and it was amongst the cast was Conan O'Brien and Robert Smigel and Bob Odenkirk and Andy Richter. Lorne Michaels was looking for people for SNL, and so Franklin Davis, our great senator from Minnesota, Al Franken, and the late Tom Davis, his former writing partner, they were sent to Chicago and they went to see this show miraculously, and they hired Conan and Smigel and Odenkirk for SNL. And so they, for two, 3 years, they kept pitching this idea of the Chicago sports fans, this sketch that they had done in Chicago. And everyone was like, so finally Joe Mantegna hosted it. And he was interested. So it got on the air. And I thought it was hilarious because, you know, Joe's a friend. And, then a few months later, I was hosting. Oh, that was a Bears game against the Giants. And the Bulls were making a run in the spring to the championship. And so that was, they asked me if I would do it. And so that's why I was sitting in with my brother Bill and my brother Bob. I can never remember who was there because Joe wasn't available at the time. So, yeah, we did a lot of those. And we still do stupid things. We had fun with those characters. They're completely ridiculous. I think we did a State Farm commercial 2 years ago with Aaron Rodgers. My first shot of the morning was, okay, lay down on this massage, take off your clothes, lay down on this massage table, and Coach Dick is gonna, you know, give you a massage, and then smoke a big cigar and stuff. And, those characters were so lately homosexual, and I was, instead of those massage pillows, it was a ring bologna, And so, it was my dream sequence. It turns out I fell asleep on a plane next to Aaron Rodgers, so I was gnawing on his shoulder. And then he went down on his shoulder. Those characters are fun.
So do you, with years of playing Norm, I would imagine that, do you go to a bar and people just buy you beer all the time?
It can happen.
It does happen. Do you, can I buy you a beer?
Quite certain.
Okay. I'm at now.
Yeah. I'm not much of a day drinker, to be told, but I appreciate the gesture.
But it just happens to be I'm a company that makes my glasses, so. Do you have any other further comments about Norm's famous episode while I pour these down, if I should have done it earlier?
I'm sorry.
Do you have any other further comments about Norm, any favorite scenes, any favorite, maybe why did he talk about her? Why didn't he never see her?
Oh, you didn't want to see her. It was just a mercy rule for the audience.
And who was your favorite character to play off of? You had Woody, you had Sam, you had Carla.
Jeez. It was Murderer's Row, I can't really pick anyone out because, Don, obviously, we had a tremendous chemistry, but it was the same with everybody. I'm not going to tell you about the spitballs. You know how I sat at the waitress station, basically, or right next to it? Hey, thanks.
It's an Alec Guinness pint glass, get it?
That's cool, that's a good idea. Now, you know how you know when it's settled, you got to take an old Irish pound.
May I have your attention, please? Can I have Matt Simon meet your party on the fifth floor of the west side?
The brown
once again, Matt Simon, please meet your party on the west side of the fifth floor. Thank you.
It's obviously kind of a kid. I didn't want to say it out loud. It's kind of to do a convention, so I'm sure everything's fine. Is Matt Simon here? That'd be hilarious to us.
I had all the beer, so I had a little cocktail napkins and little cocktail straws. And so I just take a little nip of the napkin and play with it in my mouth and threw a little straw. I was deadly. I think clear across the bar. So I used to like to pick on Woody, because once in a while he had a little chunk of, you know, a paragraph to say instead of just the, you know, one-liner. So I used to just pelt his forehead. You've got like freeze frame on your DVDs, you can see like just and but my greatest moment was Ed's mouth was open. I got him right on the uvula.
I thought we had a fun little idea, is that you know you have Norm Wittesisms, right?
All right.
You know what those are, so I want you guys to help me out. So what we're going to do is I'm going to say, you know, one of those questions that Woody or Sam or Carl would ask, and then Norm would respond. You guys know what I'm talking about? But what happens before that happens? He walks in the bar and he goes, okay, so every time I go like that, I want you guys to go Norm, and so whatever, what's next door, like a Star Trek panel, or whatever, I want them to hear it. And then I was going to give Mr. Wendt a script and he was going to read off it as we do it, kind of like, you know, just a part in the episode. But he has challenged me that he's going to make me possibly remember them. So we're going to see how we're going to do it. Are you guys ready? Are you ready, Mr. Wendt?
I'm going to bat a 9 out of 10.
Really?
I think so.
Wow. Alright, so here we go.
Norm!
How's your beer sound, Norm? You got 9 more, so. How's your beer sound, Norm?
Drink me?
Do you want me to say it? I don't know, I usually finish them before they get a word in.
More clever, those kind of players.
Can I draw you a beer, Norm?
I know what they look like, just pour it.
There you go. All
right.
This Norm!
I'm gonna get old.
That's the last one. All right. What would you say to a nice beer, Norm?
Hello, sailor, new account.
This one's mine.
Is that right?
Yeah. Well, there's actually two where he says the same thing. One says going down, but one says sailor, new account. What's new, Normie? This one's long, but it's funny. Terror, Sam, the tip of my stomach and the demanding beer. This one's being asked by Coach. What'll it be, Norman? Just the usual, Coach. I'll have a froth of beer.
No.
And a snorkel.
Nick used to sometimes garble the setup lines, which, you know, left me out to dry, you know, like I think the punchline for the setup was supposed to be, how's life treating you, Norm? And my answer was, like I just ran over his dog. so you go, hey, Normie, want a beer? Like I just ran over his dog, thanks. Okay, take two. Normie, how are you doing? Gag reels were fun.
Great. Let's see if we have any questions from the audience. Do you have any questions from the audience here? Elias, are you still here with Mike? Where's Elias? Where's my mic at? Oh, it's her. Okay.
There's two of us.
What's that?
There's two on each side.
Oh, like the set. Okay, cool.
Hey, George, thanks for being here today. I just wanted to follow up on the Superfans conversation. I heard that at some point they were planning a movie, and that you guys have actually done a live reading of the script. I just wanted to kind of get your thoughts on how far along in the development process that was and how the strip reading went.
Well, it was a long time ago. It was before Chris Farley died. And so that, it's pretty far along, but as soon as Chris died, that was the end of it. So then maybe like whatever years later, as a benefit concert for Chris Farley Foundation, we did a reading of it with lots of folks helping out. And it was hilarious, way too long.
What was the premise?
It was a new sport, fan ball, where Chris was inside of a bubble, and all the fans. There was no teams. There was just 50,000 New York fans versus 50,000 Chicago fans trying to push this boy in a bubble, Chris, over the past the goal line. And, it had all sorts of, these guys, Bob Odenkirk and Robert Smigel, very, very clever, very vicious satirists, so they took swipes at everything, the culture. But it was a fun read, but rest in peace, Chris.
Sure. Thank you. So we have a question over here.
Hey, Jerks, thanks for being here. How was your experience working on House? Yes.
Yeah. Well, it was fun. Thanks. Playing around with a monster on a fishing line, it was fun, and Bill Cat was really, really fun. And turns out the director and I grew up in the same neighborhood on the south side of Chicago, Stephen Miner, and so it was a good time. And I don't have some amazing stories. Cheers is so much different. We had a lot of downtime. We were all together every day. Movies are such a more dry process. And you can't really mess around.
All right. Thank you. We have a question over here.
Hi, George. It's great to see you. What is the funniest thing you think Norm ever said?
Well, I think the gold standard is probably Dog Eat Dog World. I'm wearing no bone underwear. There's a couple of others that rival it, Dear Norman, yeah, Coach, but stop me at one. I got 1:30. What's shaking on all four cheeks and a couple of chins? And third one.
Hi, Doug. I was just curious if you could talk about a couple of your villain roles that you've done, like on the Masters of Horror episode Family by John Landis, or my favorite, King of the Ants, which scared the crap out of me when I saw you on that.
Landis asked me if, he said, "Now, Joe, if I got an ear, nose, and throat surgeon to come in and shoot string a camera up your nose and down your throat, would you be okay with that?" And I was like, "Oh, Jesus." Because I have a pretty strong gag reflex. And, so I said, "Yeah, it's a ear, nose, and throat surgeon, so what the hell?" And this couple was torturing me and with some device, and they were going up my nose, and Landis wanted to see my vocal cords, and I'm screaming, And the crew, meanwhile, it was the last shot of the night, it was like 3 a.m. And the crew had, you know, like a puke bucket there for me. And they had a pool going as to whether I'm going to puke or not. And so I told John, yeah, I'll do it, but I want the final shooting script to read Interior George Wendt. So that's the way it landed. But I was really, the most shocking thing was I couldn't believe how much hair I had in my nose. The camera going up in there, it was like a forest.
Okay, what's that right here? What's that?
I'm a huge fan, but who was your favorite person you met from Cheers?
My favorite person I met?
From Cheers, yeah.
Well, there's the whole cast, you know, but apart from the cast, we had a lot of fun guest stars. I'm thinking John Cleese jumps out right off the bat.
That's always been my favorite episode of the John Cleese.
I think he did 2 or 3.
He was like the marriage counselor for the two of them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He was
great.
Hi, Mr. Wendt. You talked a little bit about the night when it was a final episode and you're on the tech show and you all came to the actual Cheers in Boston. I think we kind of echoed stories about that. It seemed like you all had a good time with being kind of on TV with the show like a wild, crazy night.
Yeah, well, NBC thought it would be good to have us do the Tonight Show, and Jay Leno was brand new on the job. He was trying to, have control over it, but what happened was it was a 2-hour episode, I think, and nobody thought to feed us, and so we just pounded drinks because it was such an occasion. So we were just, hammered. not cute at all. It was icky, and poor Jay was trying to keep it together, and we were just, there might have been, I don't know what, we just were incorrigible. But, so I apologize for that one.
That's a great question, by the way. Who do we have next? What do you think?
You had, on the set of Cheers, you had maybe hundreds and hundreds of not beers. If you had a choice, what would have been your beer choice to be in that glass every day or most days on the set?
That feels like it would be bordering on an endorsement. You'd have to back up the truck.
That's a good point. I guess any beer company in the world would pay anything almost to get into it.
I've done my share of beer commercials.
I think
I wanted to remind you here. Coors thing here, and a lot of overseas, like Denmark and Ireland and Canada.
That's a great question, because had you answered, let's just say your answer was Foster's, which is not, because nobody likes that beer. It would be all over the internet. Norm Peterson endorses Foster's Blue Hero. He didn't say that I did, and okay. Where's our next question?
Yeah, I do my standard answer. So what's your favorite beer is free and free life.
Hey, Mr. Wendt, just wanted to ask you a question. Was the day I touched upon what your tab actually was?
What?
Your tab.
Oh, my tab. No, some guy, at least one guy, has done it. Figured it out from binge watching, I guess. And I honestly, I don't know the answer, but some guy figured it out.
That's a great question. Thank you for your service. I see your hat. Over here.
Hi, George. Just a quick question, going back to beer for a minute. What is your take on the microbrew explosion? Are you into those, or is it the bigger brands that you...
No, I...
Without naming any brands, of course.
No, you know, the microbrew thing is amazing. And, you know, my ammo lately is... you know, when I go through those, you know, like region or town X, Y, or Z, I you know, look up and ask around, like, what's the cool local craft brew, if you will. And also, you know, the cool, you know, macro brew, you know, sometimes they have regionally. And so, yes, I like all that stuff. It's pretty amazing.
Thank you. Next question, where are they? I don't see. Oh, there's one.
Somebody ran right back.
You can ask a second question. I like the first question, so you're cool if you got a second one. Can I say my favorite beer?
Yeah.
It's Exxon Kiela. It's out of Bavaria. It's a Ralph Pierce from Pierce, very good. No one cares, so I thought I'd say it. I'm not a question, so it's, you know. I'm holding it. You had a good question last time, so you got to have a good one, too.
I don't think it's good. So they actually, what did they pour you, actually, is on set? Yeah. The show, was it actually something?
Well, it was near beer, you know, so non-alcoholic beer. And there weren't a lot of choices like there are now. So it was Kingsbury Brew near beer from Cincinnati, and it wasn't available on draft. So we had cases of cans of it, but the producers wanted it from other tap handles. So they poured it into like Coca-Cola dispensers. And of course, well before shooting, because, you know, props department had more important things to do. And it came out kind of warm and flat. So they said, that doesn't look good. And so the prop man put every beer glass on the set had a pinch of salt in the bottom. So it was salty, warm, flat, beer.
That sounds terrible. Way in the back.
Hi, George. From America. Cheers was one of my all-time favorite shows, and one of my favorite episodes was when you carried Mr. Drake across the lawn in his pajamas so Rebecca could escape. You remember that episode, I'm sure?
Yeah. I remember Tom Skerritt being way heavier than he looks.
My question to you is, what is your favorite episode and why?
It was that Jumping Jerks. And no real reason. Although, if you wanted to go for, like, say, a Norm-focused story, I always found those... I thought the show was at its best when everybody has their sort of proper function. You know, where it's like a Sam and Diane romantic thing. And, you know, each of the characters had a nice little joke or entrance or, you know, B story, if you will, or a teaser or a tag. But so once in a while, we'd all get these episodes that focus on, you know, Cliff or Carla or Woody or something. And so Rhea's sister, Heidi Broman, terrific comedy writer, not just Rhea's sister, but she's been writing on everything forever. She wrote one called The Executive's Executioner, where I had a job, which, you know, weird. And the job, they found out that I was good at giving the hatchet to firing people, because I burst into tears. I was so compassionate every time I had to fire somebody, I would burst into tears. So now everyone in the company is like a big farmer, apparently. And, somebody said they wanted to know if you wanted to have a beer. Cheers is normal. No, you're getting the axe. It was fun.
I remember that one. Thank you.
Cool.
Get right there. Hey, George.
Hi.
How you doing? So.
Ooh. FOMO.
One of the things that divided your character is, of course, is drinking beer, but otherwise you did touch upon it. You're an accountant for a big portion of the show. My wife is also an accountant here. And she wanted to ask a question, but didn't feel like asking it, so I'm here for her. Have you ever had anyone come up to you and be like, you're such an idol for accountants?
Yeah, they're usually postmen, but yeah.
That's a good point. Norm Peterson is probably the most famous accountant on television. Has there really been one? I mean, Cliff would be the most famous postman, obviously.
Yeah. I don't know. Yeah, I was out of work for the most part, so.
Well, he was an out of work accountant, right?
Out of work accountant. He didn't have a particularly good relationship with his wife. And it was well overweight. So these are the perils and evils of drink. That was the subject.
And I wish I didn't know this, but your actual wife in real life, did the voice of her?
She did.
I didn't know that. Until
there was one to see her.
Oh, no, I was just saying. All right, so now that question, where are we going to go? How about blue shirt over there with the questions? You got another one?
Yeah.
Right frame.
Okay. Are you in contact with anyone from Chiasco, and so who?
Yes, everybody. Not every 2 seconds, but probably most of the lead would be Woody, Rhea, Ted, John. I see BD, I see Kelsey, I see Eric Shelley, everybody, Kirstie. Yeah.
Is there any time you guys have all been together since
I don't think so. It's really hard,
Everybody has to know pretty
family. Everybody's got families, and, Woody lives in Hawaii.
Woody, and he's been busy, too. He's had several movies come out this year.
Yeah.
And he's in Han Solo coming out.
Yeah.
He's coming out in a couple of months. He's got a lot of time. He's a busy guy, so we got another question way in the back, and it might be our last, right? So our last question.
Okay, last year, as you know, John Ratzenberger was here, and we started a Facebook page called Bring Back Norm and Cliff. Have you any idea about that? What's going on with that?
Oh, yeah, just we were sitting here, and in the conversation we were having about, they did Frasier after Cheers, and we were thinking Norm and Cliff would be a great episode. And then my friend Rob here in the front row, he actually started a Facebook page while the panel was happening. And so thank you for bringing that. It's so funny that somebody would remember that from the audience. But they really wanted to do a Cliff and Norm show. Wouldn't it be hilarious? I'm sorry, Norm and Cliff show.
I don't know. I mean, I always imagined Norm would be, managing a sober living house somewhere.
Yeah, it's called Bring Back Cliff and Norm. It has 163 members. Okay, very good. That's a great lineup. We would love to see Norm back. We only do 7 different iterations of Norm on 7 different shows, so maybe someday we'll see an 8th. Possibly?
Yeah.
I think it would be great. Well, just a few more people to ask
back here. Thank you so much.